On behalf of Department of Biotechnology and RBVRR Women's College, we'll welcome you, sir, for this session. Before we start the lecture, I want to introduce our guest speaker today. Brief introduction about him. Dr. Nirmanya Ganguly, sir, did his bachelor's and master's degree from Bangalore University. He obtained his doctorate degree from the University of Delhi South Campus. And his doctoral work was focused on direct delivery of transgene in the mammary gland for production of therapeutic proteins. He worked as a research associate at the National Institute of Immunology, New Delhi, on developing easy methods of transgenesis through testicular route as well as spermatogonial stem cells or germ cells transplantation study. He joined National Institute of Animal Biotechnology in the year 2017. Sir is at present working on development of genetically engineered livestock for agricultural applications and biomedical research. He has specialization in the area of transgenesis, generation of animal bioreactor, direct mammary gland transfection, genome and protein engineering. He is experienced in the generation of transgenic mice, generation of gene knockdown mice using shRNA, genome engineering through CRISPR-Cas system, generation of various ubiquitous tissue-specific mammalian expression vectors, production of therapeutic protein in milk, and testicular germ cell depletion and stem cell transplantation work. With this brief introduction, I welcome Dr. Ganguly again for delivering his lecture on genetic manipulation for increasing productivity in farm animals. I welcome you, sir. Once again.
Thank you, madam. Very good morning to everybody. And I first want to thank Dr. Nanda Devi and Principal so giving me this opportunity to give this guest lecture today. So I always feel very happy whenever I get such kind of opportunity because it's give me this pleasure to go back to that place from where basically I have come from. Before few years only, I could have seen in those seats where now the students are there, and at this particular time, I also used to thought that maybe someday I could do this, do that. So I think some of you students are also dreaming like this. So yes. First of all, I want to tell you, this is not nothing very difficult. Only things you have to do the hard work and study, and you have to understand the subject. So basically what talk I'm going to give today, I try to give it in a very simplistic manner so that you can understand that what this thing is, basically this genetic engineering or transgenesis, whatever we are doing here in a research institution. So it will give you an idea that how things happen there in a very simple mechanistic way. So now I'll share my screen. Yeah, is it visible?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So as my talk title is shown here, that it is basically based, I'm going to give this lecture on the genetic manipulation for increasing the productivity in farm animals. So whenever we talk about farm animal, it's basically those animals which we basically cultivate, like let's say sheep, pig, goat, cattle, means cow, buffalo. These are even fish also. So these are all farm animals. So nowadays might be all of you are hearing this particular term that genetic engineering, gene manipulation, genetically modified organisms. So many of you have different thoughts about it. Some of you think that it is good, some of you think that it may be bad. But in spite of that debate, you have to understand one thing, that there are very few technology available to increase the productivity. As all of you, all of us know that in front of the human civilization, there are big threats of this climate change. Then there is a huge growing population also. So if you take both things in mind, that as there are climate change, due to that, the productivity is getting less day by day in farmer ends. And also the consumption is going too high due to this huge number of population. So you should have some technology how to increase the productivity in the farm animal, because they are the one of the major food source for us or the human. So to do that, first of all, either you can go by the conventional breeding, but I will tell you one thing, if you go through this conventional breeding process, that basically helps to get the good characters or the good trait of the animal to propagate. But it takes a lot of time. It takes years, let's say 20 years, 30 years, because you have to select those good animals. I mean, suppose you take an example, if you want to increase the meat productivity, so you have to choose good goat who has good character or trait. Let's say few goat, as you can see in streets or in, if you go in some farm, you can see there are varieties of goats. Some of the goats are very good health, some are very ill health. So basically you have to choose those good health breeds, then you have to crossbreed them, and then you have to make a line, then you have to propagate. So it takes years, because a goat lifespan almost 4-5 years, then it has sexual maturity, lot of things you have to consider. But to bypass this huge time and you to have the gain, the same gain within a very short span of time, you have to go for this genetic manipulation. There is no other way. By, because using this genetic manipulation in a very short span of time, you can have good trait to increase productivity. So I'll go one by one. These are the three very classic example of increasing the productivity in farm animal. As you can see here, as you can see here in this is a basically fish, it's called the salmon. So you can see this is the basically average size of a salmon, and this is the genetically manipulated salmon. So the size of this particular genetically modified salmon is almost twice the size of the wild type salmon. So this increases the productivity. So if you basically cultivate this kind of salmon, it will give you more fish mass, so you can feed more people. This is also another example of a bull. This is called myostatin knockout bull. So here the myostatin is a protein. If you knock out that particular protein in the muscle tissue of any animal, let's say it's a bull or it's a goat, so the muscle production increases. As you can see here, this is not the normal muscle of a normal bull. It's the myostatin knockout bull. So it has a huge muscle mass. So the same bull, which may give you, let's say, 400 kgs of meat, but this can give you the 600 or let's say 650 kgs of meat. So the productivity is getting increased. Same here. Also, in side by side, the increase in the productivity, you have to think about the quality of the food. So here, in case of pig, you can understand, in pig, there is a huge fat layer, which is not at all good nowadays. As you can know, that there are huge risk of ischemic heart disease, heart blockage, heart failures are occurring due to the huge cholesterol and fat levels in the blood. So if you consume this kind of pig meat regularly, there is always chance of various kinds of heart diseases and fat-associated diseases. But this is a genetically modified pig where this particular fat production has been knocked down. So you can see here the amount of fat is very less this kind of pig meat. So this all has been possible only by the genetic manipulation process or the genetic engineering or transgenesis process. Now an example, till now I was talking two different terms. Maybe you get confused that what is this genetic manipulation and what is this transgenesis. So genetic manipulation is manipulating the genome of a particular organism. Now, like we are human being, we have a particular genome. If you take example of a cattle or if a goat, they have their own genome. So if you want to manipulate their genome, means suppose I want to knock out or cut out a particular part which is not required for increasing meat production, that I can do. So that is one kind of manipulation. Suppose I want to express or I want to produce something extra in their meat or in their milk. So that is also one kind of manipulation. I am adding something extra. So these are the basically genetic manipulation, addition, deletion or alteration of genomic part from the genome of an organism is the genetic manipulation. And by the process we achieve this kind of genetic manipulation is called the process of transgenesis. In basically in the business of transgenesis, we basically introduce a foreign gene or an extra copy of a gene of an other organism. Transgene. That's why the process is called the transgenesis. Now, and these things is achieved by this recombinant DNA technology or the gene cloning. So, first of all, we have to understand the basic. What is the basic principle of molecular biology? The basic principle of molecular biology relies in this central dogma. This is the process of replication. I think there are postgraduate students, so it is not very difficult for you people to understand. So, this is basically three steps of the cellular processes. Replication, that is the DNA replicate itself to generate another copy of the DNA. Then there is a transcription from DNA, which will generate the RNA. Then from RNA, the protein are synthesis. So that is called the translation. So this is the basically the central dogma of the molecular biology. And in recombinant DNA technology, we basically manipulate this system using a bacterial system. That is recombinant DNA technology. In that particular technology, this is an example. In bacterial cell, there are plasmids. These are very small genetic material of 5 kb to some 20 kb, 30 kb size. In that small genetic material, we basically propagate our own gene of interest. As you can see here, this is the picture of this electron micrograph of a plasmid DNA. You can see here. So these plasmids are isolated from the bacterial cells. You can see here, this is the isolated plasmid DNA. This is cartoon diagram. Now, in this plasmid DNA, suppose I want to propagate another part of DNA. So that we have to do by the gene cloning. You can see here, we have to cut this plasmid DNA using two restriction enzymes. Then we have to cut our desired DNA from some other organism's genome. You can see here, this is the genome of another organism. This is basically cell. From that, we isolate the DNA. And that DNA also we cut by two restriction enzymes. Then that particular fragment is ligated into this plasmid DNA. Now, utilizing this plasmid, basically, we propagate this small fragment of our own choice of DNA. And it is again put back into that equalized cell and it gets propagated. So we are basically cloning and propagating that particular part of the DNA here in a culture flux. Then again, we isolate the plasmid. So now my plasmid is carrying this particular part of the DNA, which is my gene of interest. So this is called gene of interest. Now, this gene of interest can be anything. If we want to knock down the particular protein which is hindering the muscle production, let's an example of myostatin. So if I want to knock down the myostatin, so there may be some element which basically block this production of myostatin protein. Or if I want to express something extra, let's say any protein which increase the muscle mass, so I can introduce that DNA, so that will express their overexpress. So that can be anything based on my choice. So that's why it is called gene of interest. Now my gene of interest is ready. Now the next step is that how to introduce this gene of interest into the whole organism. Now imagine of an organism. Let's say an example of a goat. A goat, if you see a mature goat, it's a huge size. Now how you can introduce that extra genetic material or the transgene into the each and every cell of that particular goat. In an adult goat, it's very difficult to target each and every cell of that particular goat because it has matured now, it has developed. It has different organs, in different organs, there are different cells. So now once it has been grown mature, it is very difficult to basically introduce that particular gene of interest in each and every cell of that goat. But imagine when this goat was in embryonic state, I mean at just after the fertilization process. So for that, you have to understand a little bit of the fertilization and reproduction process. You can see here. Yeah, so this is basically after fertilization, this is the zygote, this is called the zygote. And this zygote is developed and just a second. Sorry, just a second, sorry, I just actually mixed one slide. Yeah. Yes. So basically, you have to do this business that when you want to introduce the particular transgene in each and every cell type of that organism, you have to go back when that particular animal was in the embryonic stage. So for that, you have to understand a little bit of reproductive biology. So I just give a very brief introduction to the reproductive biology. What happened in reproduction? In case of mammal, the sperm are produced. You can see here, this is the process of spermatogenesis. Through which the sperm are produced. This is basically testes. In testes, there is a particular architecture. There are tubules. Inside the tubules, there are germ cells which divide and differentiate and develop into the mature sperm. And it come out through this duct. And then it's released there. And you can see here, this is the sperm. And this is the oogenesis process. In oogenesis, basically the eggs are produced. You can see here, this is the ovary. From here, the eggs going mature and it comes out as a ova. And the sperm go inside to this path and it fertilizes the ova and this fertilization process takes place into this particular tube and there it develops into a zygote. You can see here, this is a nice photograph of the process. This is basically the fertilization process. This is the egg and it is getting fertilized by the sperm. Once it gets fertilized, only one single sperm is allowed to fertilize a particular egg. Though there are many sperm take place in part into the process, but only single sperm sperm basically fertilize the egg. Once it gets fertilized, then the embryonic development starts. You can see here, this is the zygote, then this is the blastomere. Basically, it is two cell stage. Then there is a four cell morula stage, eight cell. Then this is called the early blastocyst. Then you can see it is the hatched blastocyst. And this is the blastomere cavity. So then it get implanted into the uterus, and after that the pups are born. This is, I am showing here, it is in mice. So in every mammal, in goat, the process remains the same. Because our model organism is the mice, so I am explaining these things in the mice. So now you can understand that if I can be able to introduce my gene of interest when this organism is in single cell stage, and it can get introduced into the genome of that particular organism, then in the process of division and differentiation, that transgene, what I have introduced into this single cell stage, will basically propagate and will be present in each and every cell of the particular organism, because I have put it when it was in a single cell state. And from that particular single cell, all other cells and organs of the body have been formed. So my gene of interest, which I introduced in this particular single cell state, will also pass on into the each and every cells of the body. So that is the process of the transgenesis. As you can see here, in this transgenesis process, as I already shown that zygote, so now that zygote I have taken under a microscope, and it's a basically machine. I'll show you the photograph of that particular machine. Then there are two types of pipette. I think all of you have seen the pipette in your molecular biology lab. So these are very fine nanometer scale pipette. You can see here. Here, this is called the holding pipette, through which we hold that particular embryo. You can see this is the nucleus. Once sperm fertilizes the ova, there are two nucleus, one from the sperm, another from the egg. Both of them get fused. Once they get fused, the cell division starts. So before they get fused, we have to catch hold of this embryo, and you have to inject our gene of interest into the nucleus. So this is the bigger one. As you can see here, this bigger one, this is the male pronucleus. So basically, inject through this injection pipette. This is a very fine glass pipette. We inject or introduce our gene of interest into this male pronucleus. Then these both pronuclear fuse. This is the injection process. As you can see here, here we are picking. Then after the picking, we release the DNA and we take out the needle. Then we transplant back these oocyte or embryos into the uterus. And there it basically mature and develop the pups. So you can see here. So now this pups has been generated. So this is the process basically. You can see here this cartoon diagram in this particular process. You can see this is the holding pipette. We have catch hold of this embryo. And we have injected, this blue color is the basically transgene solution. Now we have injected the transgene. Now it has been integrated. As you can see here, this is the genome. These are the all small copies of our transgene, and it has been integrated into the genome. Now it has been passed through and present throughout each and every cell of the particular organism, and the pups are born. So this is the process how we can introduce the transgene or our gene of interest into an organism. And it was started very early, 1960s, 70s. Then this transgenesis first has been established into the mice by Gordon et al. And this term was also coined by these Gordon and Rudolph, these two fellows. Then it has come through a lot of development and process. And nowadays, almost each and every species has been generated as a transgenic. There are transgenic goat, there are transgenic pig, cow, buffalo, then there are fish. All and each and every animal transgenesis has been happened. You can see here, this is the machine. This is called the DNA micro injector or micro manipulator. This is basically a microscope. Here we have two different needles, as I have shown you. This is called the pipette. This is the holding pipette. This is the injection pipette. There will be petri dish. On that petri dish, we have our oocyte. You can see here in this microscope. This computer attached to this microscope showing that particular photographs. So then we inject those things. These are the basically piping through which we go through. And here we attach our pipette, the glass pipette, and we inject it here. So basically, this is a very difficult process. As you can see here, these are the these are own laboratory micrographs. You can see these are all different embryos in different cellular stages. These are two cell stage, these are four cell stage, and two of them are showing this green fluorescence protein expression. This is GFP. I think all of you know have heard about this GFP. It is basically a protein which was first isolated from one of the jellyfish, Aquaria victoriae. And from that jellyfish, this protein has a properties of fluoresce. If you give a particular emission of UV on this and it get excited, it emits the fluorescence green color. So through that we track basically. GFP has basically using as a tracking molecule. So you can see here, once we inject the transgene into these two embryo, that GF, that protein fluoresces. So we can track it that the process has been successful in for this particular, these two particular embryo, this one and this one. But as I have already shown, this process has various drawbacks. First of all, it's very inefficient. As you can see here in this particular statistics, this is the statistics of this particular process in different organisms like sheep, cow, goat. You can see the percentage is very less, 0.3%, 0.2%, 0.5%. And it is very costly affair. You need millions of the dollars. You can see here, this is the cost estimation, almost. And it's very time consuming. You can see here, it's almost $25,000 to develop one pig, transgenic pig. So for a country like India, it is very difficult to get to that, establish into that particular process and to use it in a regular basis. So in our laboratory, what we are doing, we are trying to develop a better and easy process to bypass this cost effective and basically this inefficient method. So for that, we have developed and generated the testicular transgenesis method. Now I'll explain you what is this testicular transgenesis method. Just now I have explained you that how this transgenesis occurs. Basically, we take this zygote and we inject our transgene. Now go a little bit back. How these zygotes are forming? It is forming by the fertilization of the sperm and the egg. The sperm comes from the testis, egg comes from the ovary. Both of these fused and develop this zygote. Now, instead of delivering our DNA into the zygote, if we can deliver our DNA or the transgene into the testis, and if it gets attached to the sperm, then also our work is done, our job is done, because that sperm will carry our DNA, it will fuse with the egg, and that egg will form the zygote, and slowly it will differentiate and develop into a whole organism. So if we can deliver our transgene into the sperm also, we can achieve the same process, but better easiness and better efficiency. And also it's very cost effective. So for that, what we have done, you can see here, this is the mice. We have established this process first in the mice. So you can see this is the mice, this is the mice testis. So we have anesthetized the mice, it is in senseless. Then in the testis, directly inject the DNA into the testis. In the testis, if you study detail, you can find out there are germ cells. So that germ cells basically divide and differentiate and generate the sperm. So what will happen once we deliver this transgene solution into the testis germ cell, it is there outside in the germ cell. Then what we do, we give a mild electric pulse. It's a very mild pulse. One using this electrode, this is called tweezer electrode. This is basically round cell electrode. This is a positive and negative side. And we have a machine, it's called electroporator. It basically generates that electric pulse. Then we hold the testis with this electrode and it gives a very mild pulse. Once we give that very mild pulse, that transgene, what we have delivered into the testis, it gets inside the germ cell, means here. And that germ cell basically divide and differentiate and develop into sperm. So now my transgene is being carried by the sperm. So now my job is done. So once this is done, we leave the mice for 30 days. Because from that particular germ cell to develop a sperm, it takes almost 20 to 30 days in case of mice. So whatever transgene has been delivered into the germ cell, now it will develop into sperm. And that sperm will fuse with the egg and it will develop a full organism in case of mice. So now with this process, we can generate a transgenic mice very easily, only by delivering the transgene into the testis and giving a mild pulse. So we have basically bypassed this whole big system of using this big machine, then so much of cost, and we have bypassed everything, the time, and we have developed a very easy method of the generating this transgenic animal. Now next part is that, what kind of productivity you want to increase? I'll give a very small example. Now to increase the productivity, suppose I want to increase the productivity of the meat, or let's say in our country there is a huge problem of therapeutics. As you know, this COVID also, there are very less vaccines available because our production limit is very limited. If you take the example of other proteins, I'll give you a good example. Let's say this is a chart, or you can see it's very simple. I think almost 40% of the students sitting here, some of them near ones have this problem of the diabetes. And you can understand then what is the pain of a common people to get this insulin every day. If you go by, this is the brand name in which the insulin level is, this is called Novorapid. It's almost 600-900 unit for 1800 or 2700 rupees. So very common man who do not have a very huge high earning, if he has to take insulin every month, so he has to spend basically approximately 3000 rupees from his pocket every month. And this is a very simple example of insulin. You take other examples of other therapeutic protein, like this blood coagulation factor 7, 8 or 9, they have to take for this hemophilia, then there are different interferons. These are huge costs. You can see here 20,000 for the blood coagulation factor, like for interferons, they have to pay near about 28 to 52,000. Then there are growth hormone, somatropin, this is the brand name. It costs near about 7,500 to 15,000 rupees. So for a common man in India, these are very difficult. So if you want to produce this in a very cost-effective manner, then we can use this farm animal. Now you can ask me how. You know that milk is produced at the time of lactation. That's a natural process. So at the time of lactation, when milk is being produced and mammary gland is in highly secretory state for expression of the milk protein. So if we can put a transgene into that particular lactating animal, and I develop a transgenic animal which has any of the CD, any of gene of any of these therapeutic proteins, let's say interferon or factor VIII, and it gets activated at the time of lactation in mammary gland. So in the milk, that protein will be expressed, and we can simply take out the milk. And once we take out the milk from that particular, from the milk, we can separate out that particular therapeutic protein. So it will become very simple. Now it is what happened. You have to put big companies with big fermenters. Then there will be all different cell lines. They will culture it in fermenter. Then they will put their transgene into that. Then they will take out the media from there. They will basically purify. But all these mammalian cell or bacterial system, they have different contaminating protein, which creates a lot of immune compromisation to the individual whom you are injecting those therapeutics. But milk is a very safe method or process to express those therapeutics. So what will happen? We have to basically develop a construct. In that particular transgenic construct, there will be a promoter. Now I'll explain you what is a promoter. All of us have studied the transcription. In transcription, the gene transcribes into RNA, and that is lead by a promoter element. Now, promoter element, if I want to explain you simplify, you can take this example. This is that jellyfish, Aquarian Victorian. It basically glows green, chemiluminescent, fluorescent. Now, in that fluorescence, it has a particular protein. So, if you take out the cell of that jellyfish, in that DNA, there is an element which basically expresses this fluorescent protein. So, take an example of a train. So, here, this compartment is the gene which expresses, and this engine is the promoter. So basically this engine leads this compartment that where this train has to go. So for this GFP protein, that promoter is that engine which helps it to direct that it has to express in this particular cell. Same is here, suppose it is me, and in my skin there is a protein called keratin. So now that keratin protein also has a same kind of system. It has an engine that's called the promoter, and it has a gene that basically express. So that keratin protein engine or the promoter directs this keratin protein that it has to express into the skin. So what will happen using this recombinant DNA method? I will isolate both the DNA, from this jellyfish for this GFP gene fluorescent protein, and isolate the DNA from my skin cell for this keratin, and I will cut this engine and cut this DNA, and if I mix and match it, and I develop a transgene construct where this GFP is under control of my skin promoter, that is keratin promoter, that is basically the engine. And I have this transgene cassette, and I deliver it into the mice using this transgenesis method, as I have explained now in testicular transgenesis. So in this mice, which is transgene positive for this keratin promoter and the EGFP, and if I take out its skin, you can see this is the skin, and once I observe it under the microscope, you can see that GFP is specifically expressed under that keratin promoter that is in the outer layer of the skin. You can see here, this is the nice EGFP expression only into the outer layer of the skin due to the promoter of keratin gene family. So GFP is now guided by this keratin promoter. So in the same way, what we can do to express all these therapeutic protein, we can take the therapeutic protein gene. These are all human protein, so we can take human gene, human insulin, human coagulation factor, human interferon, human growth hormone, and we can take them and we can paste them under the promoter, that promoter which will express this protein into the mammary gland at the time of lactation. So for that, what we have done, we have isolated, you know, there are different proteins. One of the protein is beta casein. There are beta casein, there are alpha casein, there is beta lactoglobulin. So what we have done, we have basically taken out the beta casein promoter. And under that beta casein promoter, that we have taken out from the buffalo genome. Because buffalo, the milk production is very high, buffalo protein quantity is very high in milk. So we have taken that buffalo beta casein promoter, and under that buffalo beta casein promoter, we have cloned the cDNA or the gene of all these therapeutic protein. And we have developed transgenic mice. And you can see here, this is basically marker protein EGFP. So under that buffalo protein, our marker protein GFP is expressing. In the same way, now this has established in the mice. So what we have done it in the rabbit. So we have basically cloned this human interferon gamma gene under buffalo beta casein promoter. And you can see here, we have delivered that transgen into the rabbit testis. This is the rabbit testis. Here we have delivered this transgen, this blue color. This is a basically dye we mix with the DNA solution to track it, whether it has been gone inside the testis or not. Here we have not injected. This is non-injected testis. This is injected testis. Then we give this electric pulse. Then we put this rabbit for the mating, and the pulse generated. And you can see in the you can see the expression of the EGFP in the testis. So this confirms that the gene has gone inside the testicular germ cells. These are the tubule we have cultured. And in this tubule, you can see the nice GFP expression. And when we have taken out the cross-section of the testis in the germ cells, these are basically testicular architecture. These are the germ cells in the testis. And it is showing this expression of our transgene. You can see here, this is the control testis, non-injected testis. There is no expression. Here, there is expression. So what happened? Now, once this rabbit is born, it will express our therapeutic protein, that is interferon gamma in the meat. And you can see here, we have estimated that. So this rabbit basically expressed 5.6 microgram of interferon gamma in 1 ml of meat. So you can very easily express this interferon gamma into the milk of this rabbit using this testicular transgenesis method, bypassing all this costly and huge infrastructure based process. So like this, we are also working in our laboratory to also knock down the myostatin. So if you can knock down the myostatin, the muscle production will be used. So there will be increased meat production in the farm animal. So you can see here how we are doing the same thing into the goat. This is the goat testis we are injecting here. This is the buffalo, you can see here. This is the buffalo testis we are injecting, then we are electroporating it. So we are trying to basically achieve the same thing, increasing the productivity in the farm animal by these tools. That is genetic manipulation. We are developing different genetic construct in the laboratory using the recombinant DNA method. Then using our established, our own in-house established this testicular transgenesis method, we are trying to develop or generate this transgenic animal where this particular protein will be specifically expressed in a specific desired organ or tissue of our choice. Thank you. I am now open for the questions.
Yeah, students, do you have any questions regarding this? Have you all understood? Sir, if you don't mind, can I ask you something, sir?
Yeah, definitely.
Sir, these transgenic animals, which are used as animal bioreactors, how many of them have you produced, sir? Are they released for farming?
No, not yet. This is still under our observation and all. We are working on it.
Okay. Sir, one more thing. If we want, like everything, when situation goes normal, can we have a field trip to NIAID, sir? Is it possible?
Yeah, definitely. You can contact our admin. We used to do the same thing, but just now due to this COVID situation and all, once everything gets normal, definitely you can come with your students. We'll be happy to have you people here.
Okay, sir. Thank you very much.
Definitely. It was really nice, but this online situation is not possible to see the students' expression.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, we'll definitely try to meet us. Definitely.
Definitely, sir. Definitely. Hopefully, everything goes well, and we'll try to meet as early as possible.
Definitely.
Now, over to Simran for formal vote of thanks. Simran?
Yes, ma'am. Good morning. I am Simran, and I am here to present the vote of thanks. I would like to thank Dr. Nirmalya Ganguly, sir, for today's lecture on genetic manipulation for increasing productivity in farm animals, which was very informative and interesting. I am sure the knowledge that sir gave us will help us in our studies and future. The information regarding transgenesis and how it helps to increase the productivity in a very short span of time and various techniques employed was very valuable. I found the technique of testicular injection of transgene in order to decrease the cost of production very interesting. Once again, I would like to thank Dr. Nirmalya Ganguly sir for taking time out of his busy schedule for us. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
I would also like to thank our principal, Dr. Achita Devi, head of the Department of Biotechnology, Dr. P. Nanda Devi, the program coordinator, Ms. Nagrani, for organizing and conducting this lecture. Lastly, I would like to thank the participants for attending and giving their undivided attention to the lecture. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir, for taking time from your busy schedule.
Thank you.
Hope you meet personally.